to Calcutta Heart Clinic and Hospital. In next 30 to 45 minutes, I am going to cover these topics: NIV waveforms, interfaces, monitoring of NIV patients, some newer modes and weaning from NIV, and some newer trends of NIV use in home, mainly home based or chronic disease cases, and some miscellaneous issues. Now, first some NIV terminologies. This has been already discussed by Dr. Ghosh. Only a brief idea of the rate. The respiratory rate, it is the respiratory rate which is determined by the patient. And the rise time. Rise time is the time taken to reach the IPAP from the EPAP. EPAP is the pressure during expiration. And EPAP is the pressure delivered by the machine during inspiration. And the time from which the pressure is generating from EPAP to IPAP is the rise time. It mainly used in patient ventilator synchrony. And the inspiratory time. Inspiratory time is the how long the BiPAP units stays at IPAP. And the pressure support, it is the difference between IPAP and EPAP. And it determines the tidal volume. Wider the gap, more will be the tidal volume. Then trigger. Trigger is the point where BiPAP units transit from EPAP to IPAP. And it is the initiation of inspiration. In case of NIV, it is present triggered. And the cycle. Cycle is the initiation of expiration and end of inspiration. Here the IPAP transit and EPAP start. Now this is the graph. There is some negative, this is the pressure time graph, where some negative pressure generated by the patient and the ventilator sends the negative pressure, then it delivers the pressure, which is preset. This is IPAP. And this is the time, total time, when the inspiratory pressure or IPAP is applied. And here this is the trigger, and from IPAP, the EPAP starts. This is cycle. And this time is expiratory time. And the trigger to peak IPAP is called rise time. And the difference between IPAP and EPAP is pressure support. Now rise time. We can provide IPAP from EPAP by this way, a straight vertical line or maybe horizontal, depending on the scenario. In case of obstructive airway disease, we need shorter rise time, because in case of obstructive airway disease, there is COPD CO2 retention. So we have to exhale out the CO2. So we need expiratory time more. So rise time should be shorter. And in case of restricted disease, prolonged rise time. The tidal volume, most of the NIV are pressure cycled. Pressure cycled means inspiration and expiration, there is two pressure, and the two pressure we are going to fix, and the machine delivered to provide the tidal volume. But depending on the patient's lung compliance, airway resistance, the peak pressure is always fixed, but the compliance and the volume will change. This is the normal lung physiology, and this is the decreased lung compliance patient. IPAP, and there is, this is EPAP, and there is IPAP. And the flow, this is the flow time, this is expiration, this is inspiration, and this is expiration. And in case of poor lung compliance, the expiratory flow curve is changing due to poor lung compliance. And the volume, normal lung, high volume. And in case of poor lung, the volume is decreased, but the peak pressure is always same. A typical breath already discussed. This is the rise time, this is fall time, and T minimum is the minimum inspiratory pressure, minimum inspiratory time, and T max is the maximum inspiratory time. This is a typical breath pattern. Now the inspiratory time. inspiratory maximum ventilator, we can fix the inspiratory time. There is no modes to fix the IE ratio. So IE ratio is managed by fixing the IE time or inspiratory time. And the T max should be limited in COPD patient, because same mechanism. In COPD patient, we need to wash out the CO2. So IE ratio, expiration time will be more. So inspiratory time will be limited. And in case of restrictive lung disease like ILD or kyphoscoliosis or structural lung disease, there is IE minimum should be higher. This is the prefixed settings by ResMed in some respiratory, fixed respiratory disease, and the settings of TI max and TI minimum and the COPD. And the interesting thing is that in COPD patient, the T max is low, TI max is low, and in obstructive restrictive airway disease patient, the TI minimum is low, but T max is equal to normal. So trigger sensitivity. Trigger means transition of IPAP from EPAP. It is determined by the patient. It may be flow, pressure, or volume dependent. In usually bilevel ventilators, triggers are flow, because flow is more sensitive than pressure. These graphics, the negative pressure generated by the patient, and as soon as the ventilator detects the negative inflection, it gives the pressure, IPAP. And the flow, there is a curvature, and the flow generated by the patient, ventilator sends it and give breath. Now we can set trigger, there is 5 trigger sensitivity. It may be very high, medium, low to very low. So in case of very high trigger, the flow is very less, only 2.4 to 5 liter per minute. In very low trigger sensitivity, the flow is required very high. So in case of during the movement of the patient or tube movement, patient's movement, slight coughing may generate this type of pressure, flow, and the ventilator will give the breath. This will lead to ventilator asynchrony. And if we set very low trigger, then patient have to generate more pressure to deliver the machine, the required IPAP. So by default, we have to set the trigger sensitivity as medium, which is 6 liter per minute. Now the issues with trigger. There may be auto trigger or failure to trigger. What is auto trigger? Auto trigger means trigger is too sensitive. Slight patient movement leads to triggering. And if there is any leak around the mask, then there will be auto trigger. And in this case, we have to reduce the trigger sensitivity. Then failure to trigger. The most common cause of trigger failure in case of COPD patient is due to intrinsic PEEP. Intrinsic PEEP means the FRC is high. So the patient is unable to trigger the ventilator or to start the IPAP. So we have to increase the EPAP so that the lung can, the compliance is to some extent increased. The patient is generating, it triggers, but there is no IPAP from the machine end. So first we have to increase the EPAP. If still persists the same problem, then we have to increase the trigger sensitivity. Now cycle. Cycle is the transition of EPAP from IPAP. It is the initiation of expiration. And there is also cycle sensitivity, 5 types of sensitivity, very high, medium to very low. Suppose a COPD patient, there is CO2 retention. If we, the expiration starts here, the inspiration is less and expiration starts too early. So the CO2 can be effectively washed out. And in case of restrictive lung disease, where high oxygen deficiency is predominant, there we can increase the inspiratory time by very low cycle sensitivity. Now interfaces. There are various interfaces like nasal mask, oronasal mask, full face mask, NIV helmet or nasal pillow. First, nasal mask. It's a less risk for aspiration. It is widely used, but it has some disadvantage. In case of serious respiratory illness, try to avoid it because there is mouth leak. There is less effectiveness of nasal obstruction. The patient who are nasal breather, mouth breather, the air coming in and out through the mouth, and there is mouth dryness, but there is less risk of aspiration. It can, the patient can speak, patient can communicate, patient can eat through this mask in situ. The oronasal mask, most commonly used. It has good seal and more effective ventilation, but it is best suited for less cooperative patient and high severity of the disease, it should be used. And in case of partially breathing patient, it is better tolerated. But disadvantage is claustrophobia and regurgitation, aspiration or aspexia. Now nasal pillows. This is the newer modes of interfaces. There is two cushions which inserted in the nostril, but the problem is that the mouth is open, so acts like nasal mask. So the mouth breather and the same problem like nasal mask is also here. But in case of CPAP patients, the patients who are suffering from obstructive sleep apnea, obesity hyperventilation syndrome, who are in chronic care, may use the nasal pillow. And the pressure, it can withstand 3 to 20, it is very low. So in CPAP only, it should be used. Never used it in BiPAP. Now full face mask. It covers almost entire face, it is easy to fit, less air leaks and no pressure source. It is beneficial for mouth breathers and the patient with facial abnormality, nasal bridge, nasal ulceration, facial abrasion, we should go for full face mask. Now NIV helmet. Now monitoring of NIV patient. Now a patient is on NIV, what we have to monitor? First, look for subjective response, physiological response, and gas exchange response. Physiological response, the smooth adaptation of the patient with ventilator. This is the surest sign, and alleviation of the symptoms like dyspnea or improved tolerance. Now, physiological response. Physiological response, simple look for the vitals like chest wall movements, heart rate, respiratory rate, blood pressure, mental status. If GCS is less than 8, other than CO2 narcosis, go for intubation. And patient coordination with the ventilator. If patient is fighting, first look for any leakage, look for interface, look for machine settings, then shift to invasive ventilation. Now gas exchange response. Pulse oximetry should be continuously monitored, and in case of CO2 retained patient or type 2 respiratory failure patient, keep the SpO2 between 88 to 92 and ABG before the starting of NIV and after 1 hour. If the acidosis is improving or CO2 is going to wash out, then continue NIV. Now other factors like XL tidal volume, we are giving the pressure IPAP and EPAP, but the tidal volume is less. Suppose the patient is taking tidal volume of 200 to 300 ml, so it is ineffective. So try to adjust the tidal volume so that the patient can effectively breathe in. Look for NIV waveforms, continuous ECG monitoring, and severe neurological deterioration like mental cloudiness, drowsiness, etc. And the other indications which already discussed by Dr. Chatterjee for rapid intubation. Now some problems and complications. First, related to air pressure and flow. We are delivering NIV by mask, and when there is leakage shown by the machine, what usually we do, we tied the head strap and the pressure sore around the face mask, especially in the nasal bridge and forehead, is increased. So, to some extent, leak should be allowed, and the mask should be fitted like that. It should deliver the volume, and there is minimum leakage. And the continuous pressure will lead to air pressure in the nose, sinus. There is burning and dryness of the nasal mucosa, oral mucosa till alveoli level. There is nasal congestion, dryness, oral dryness, gastric distension, and eye irritation. Other infrequent complications are delay intubation. The patient on ventilator, we are waiting and looking for next one hour, the time goes on. So, delay in intubation is the most dreaded complication of NIV. Major cardiac arrest, hypoxemic respiratory failure, aspiration pneumonia, hemothorax, pneumothorax, hypotension, also common hypotension due to high PEEP. So, increase head strap tension, reduce air leak. And if skin breakdown increase, if we tight the face mask more. This is the nasal ulceration. Ulceration on back. So, the head strap tension should be like that. It will avoid the skin breakdown and avoid the air leaks. Now some newer modes. Volume assured pressure support. Volume assured pressure support, it combines the advantage of pressure support ventilation like NIV, and it will assure the volume. Means we are giving IPAP of 5, IPAP of 10 and EPAP of 5, but it is generating 200 tidal volume, which is insufficient. VAPS mode will give, there is a mode where we can fix the tidal volume, IPAP 15, EPAP 5 and volume 300. So, we can assure the pressure as well as the volume. And IVAPS is the intelligent volume assured pressure support. It calculates the minute volume. Suppose in first inspiration, 500 ml of air goes in. In second inspiration, there is 200. In third inspiration, there is 500. If the patient's respiratory rate is 30, then the minute ventilation is around 20. So, intelligent VAPS, it calculates the minute ventilation, and the tidal volume is given by the VAPS mode is according to the respiratory rate to meet the sufficient minute ventilation. Then adaptive servo ventilation, it is also a newer mode mainly used in the chronic care setting in case of central sleep apnea. Obstructive sleep apnea patient, we are treating with CPAP. Central sleep apnea patient, with CPAP treatment, the condition will be deteriorate. NIV is the choice, but the basic pathology behind the OSA or OHS is that there is obstruction in the airway from the nostrils to the pharynx or larynx. If the patient's positions change according to the patient's awakefulness, the obstruction varies. The adaptive servo ventilation calculates the resistance and delivers the volume or pressure. Now, assisted pressure control ventilation, it is like the pressure control ventilation in invasive ventilation. Now, weaning from NIV, a patient on ventilator, on NIV, the condition which was initially there, improved from that situation. Now, how to wean from that situation? First, on the day 2, if the patient's condition is improved, then try NIV for 16 hours on day 2. And on day 3, 12 hours intermittently, and at least 6 to 8 hours at night. And discontinue on day 4, if the continuation of NIV is not there, the conditions which requires NIV continuation is not there. Now, newer trends of NIV use, NIV in difficult weaning and extubation failure already discussed by Dr. Chatterjee. Now NIV in chronic care settings. The goal of chronic care setting is to relieve or improve the symptoms. It enhances the quality of life, increase survival and improves the mobility. The conditions which require chronic NIV is restrictive thoracic disease like chest wall disorder, obesity, hypoventilation, progressive neuromuscular disorder, spinal cord injury, hypercapnia or non-hypercapnic central sleep apnea, and chronic stable COPD, obstructive sleep apnea, cystic fibrosis, bronchiectasis, post-tubercular lung. And the conditions and the mode. Chronic respiratory failure in case of restrictive lung disease. Who can protect the airway? Who can cough effectively? BiPAP is the ideal choice. In case of OSA, CPAP is the choice. Nocturnal desaturation and hypoventilation. Try NIV. Then symptomatic restrictive thoracic disease with severe pulmonary dysfunction and vital capacity less than 50. Give NIV. Moderate to severe OSA not responding to CPAP. CPAP is the standard of treatment in OSA, but if not responding, then go for NIV. Severe symptomatic stable COPD despite optimal treatment, start NIV. Some patients of NIV, after optimizing the medical therapy and chest physiotherapy, despite of this, some patients are chronic retainer. The PCO2, baseline PCO2 is high, and there is limited exercise tolerance. Start NIV in that patient. And COPD, OSA overlap or OHS patient, start NIV. In case of COPD, OSA overlap or OHS patient, we are starting NIV because of there is CO2 retention. Hypoxia is not the problem. Problem is we have to wash out the CO2. So NIV is the choice. Now miscellaneous issues. Sedation during NIV. We applied NIV, patient is improving, but patient is fighting. We optimize our medical therapy, what to do? Then we can start sedation. There is no clear cut recommendation about that, but dexmedetomidine is widely used, and some book recommendation midazolam, though BTS advice for morphine. Then leak compensation. The ventilator will calculate the amount of leak and it will compensate. This facility is only in the portable ventilator machine, and up to 30 liter per minute leakage can be allowed. So if the ventilator calculate the leakage, it will compensate in the next breath. Then humidification. As the high flow oxygen or high flow air, high flow pressure is going through the mask, so there is dryness. So humidification is an issue. But how to use the humidification? There is a standard humidifier which is called HME, heat moisture exchanger. We can use, but HME will increase the work of breathing and increase resistance. So HME should not be used in NIV, especially in single circuit. The passover heated humidifiers, which are already inbuilt in ICU ventilator and in some advanced portable BiPAP also, the passover heated humidifier, it will help to prevent the dryness. Now oxygen delivery. In case of hypoxemia or hypercarbic patient, we have to add additional oxygen through cannula or by oxygen port. But the FiO2 is determined by some factors like oxygen flow rate. By one important point is that through portable NIV, we can give only 50% FiO2 maximum. More than 50%, we cannot give. So the oxygen flow rate, if we decrease the flow rate, FiO2 will decrease. The type of leak port in the system. In the single circuit NIV, there is an intentional leak port. Intentional leak port is for the the patient is inhaling, air goes on and patient exhaled. So CO2 comes out. So the CO2, where will the CO2 go? The patient will rebreathe. So there is an intentional port which helps in exhaling CO2. And the leak port, the type of leak port and the site of oxygen where we are blending to the circuit is also important. To achieve maximum FiO2, if the leak port is in the circuit, the oxygen blend into the patient's mask. Leak port in the circuit and the oxygen should be given in the mask. And if the leak port in the mask, then oxygen is blended into the machine outlet. And the IPAP and EPAP, lower the IPAP and EPAP levels also yield higher oxygen concentration. Then CO2 rebreathing. CO2 rebreathing is a concern with any NIV with single circuit gas delivery system, because exhalation occurs through the intentional leak port and depends on the continuous flow of the gas in the circuit. If the gas flow inadequate, then exhaled gas not adequately be flushes from the system and patient may rebreathe the exhaled CO2. Flow of the gas through the leak port depends on the I ratio and EPAP. At low EPAP, less than 4, with fast respiratory rate, flow may not be adequate and the may not adequate to flush the CO2. So EPAP more than 4 should be applied in case of single circuit ventilator. Now aerosol therapy. Maximum COPD or obstructive airway disease patient with NIV requires nebulization. So how to give NIV? The NIV can be given after removing the nebulization may be given after removing the NIV, but it will deteriorate the condition of the patient. So at the same time, we have to give the NIV support and nebulization. And the aerosol therapy, we can give through nebulizer or through the normal MDI also, metered dose inhaler. So the factors affecting the aerosol delivery during NIV is the presence and absence of humidifier in the circuit. If there is humidifier, then effectivity of the aerosol therapy will decrease. And the position of the leak port, synchronization of MDI with actuation with the inspiration. During expiration, we are giving, suppose giving the puff, then it will be ineffective. So we have to actuate the puff with inspiration. Then volume of the mask. If the volume of the mask is increased, then all the drug will deposit over the face, like full face mask or helmet. In that case, nebulization should not be given with NIV in situ. So if the leak port in the mask, aerosol delivery from the MDI is more efficient than nebulizer. And we can use nebulization by the site port, T port. And the aerosol delivery of the lower airway is less effective when administered with humidifier circuit. Thank you. Any questions?
So thank you, Dr. Chandan Sit, for delivering his lecture. We have completed our lecture session. Now it is time for lunch.